it's good to see you again this week. I'd love to hear about your week, a good thing, or a prayer request. And our would you rather for this week is, would you rather have a trampoline in your room or a slide in your room? So you can let me know. The first song we're going to do is the song that we learned last week. It's called Make Us More. Job. We're going to keep working on that one in the next couple weeks. The next song we're going to sing is one that you're very familiar with, and that's G-O-D is L-O-V-E. Going to be Hear, O Israel.
The Lord is one. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God.
good job. I'm going to turn it over to Miss Rena because she's teaching again this week. So I'll see you when I see you. Bye, friends.
Good morning, boys and girls. I'm so glad to be here this morning, and I'm glad you're here and you're watching because I have another Bible story for you. And I know you would tell me, and the stories are all from the Bible and they're true. So we're going to pray now, and then I'm going to tell you this story, this wonderful story about a man named Gideon, okay? Heavenly Father, thank you this morning that I can be here to teach this lesson. Please help the boys and girls to understand. Help me to do it exactly right, Lord, like it is in the Bible. Take care of all of my kids, Lord. You know how much I love them and how much I wish we could be together. But take care of them and all of their families and Pastor Dan and Pastor Mitchell. And keep us all safe, Lord, from the virus, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, this is about Gideon. And God had let the people there, his people, Israelite people, were supposed to be worshiping God. Instead, they were worshiping Baal. Remember, I brought pictures of Baal and other gods, and they were worshiping Baal mostly, and that's B-A-A-L. Now, I didn't bring his picture this morning because I know I've showed you that a lot of times, but when the Israelite people would harvest their crops, God let the Midianite people come in and rob them. The Jewish people would plant all of the seeds, and they would grow all of the plants to grow food, like wheat and barley and rye. That's things that they made bread and, I guess, vegetables too. And so the Midianites would let the Jewish people do all the planting and the watering and the harvesting. And then they would either come in and destroy it or they would steal it. And God let the Midianites do this. God let the Midianites do this for a while. It was about 7 or 8 years. And when the Israelite people, the Jewish people, when they harvested their crops, they would try to hide them from the Midianites. Otherwise, they would almost starve all winter, you know, and the Midianites would be eating their food. So we have Gideon, what they would do is they would hide and harvest their crops. Now, when they harvested things like wheat and barley and that, they had to throw it up into the air so that the wind would drive away what's called the chaff, you know, the dusty stuff, and then only the good stuff would come down, and then they could use it to make bread. And so the Israelite people were doing that. And so Gideon, they would try to hide all of the stuff that they were harvesting. So here is Gideon. He's in hiding out there by, the Bible said, by a place called the wine press. And he was harvesting, and then he was taking with his, here's a sickle, that he will put a sickle in his hand to show that he was, they didn't have big farm equipment that ran on with gasoline and engines. Remember, they had to do it by hand, so he would cut. My dad used to have a sickle. I know men today have these big things that they just go brrr, and it cuts everything. But my dad used to get down and he used to cut with that. And I remember my dad's sickle, so that's why I brought that. So I thought you might like to see a sickle. But anyway, Gideon is busy and he's harvesting the wheat, but he's hiding from the Midianites. And so the Bible tells us that while he is there, and you know, he's very concerned. When he prays, he says, "Oh Lord God, why do you let the Midianites come and steal our food? Why do you do this, Lord?" And so he looks over, and sitting under this tree is a man. Looks like a man. And what he's doing is he's just sitting there. He looks like a traveler. He's got a rod in his hand. Men used to use those to walk with and, you know, to make sure they didn't have sidewalks, remember? So they walked, and to make sure they didn't fall, they would carry a cane. And so Gideon was there, and he sees this man sitting over there. And of course, in those days, anybody that was traveling through and you saw them and they were strangers, you would offer them some food or something. And so I guess he thought this was a man, and so he said to the man, "Who are you?" And this man says, "Your name is Gideon, and God has chosen you to deliver your people from their enemies, from the Midianites. God has chosen you. You're going to be a great warrior. You're going to be a great warrior." And Gideon says, "Well, no," he says, my family, we're not important in the Israelite community. We're not important, and I'm the last one in my family that's important." Maybe he was the youngest, I don't know. But anyway, he didn't feel very important. And so this man says, "No, you are going to do this. You're going to deliver your people." And so Gideon says, "Well, wait, I'm going to go and fix some food for you." And so the man said, "Yes, okay, go ahead." And so Gideon did. He went and he fixed some food for them. He brought it up to the man, and the man said, "Put it on that rock." So here is the bread. He brought him bread and meat, and he also brought some broth in a jar or a pitcher or something, and he had it in this. And so this man, I'll tell you in a minute who this is. And so the man said, "Pour that broth over the meat and the bread." That doesn't sound very appetizing, does it? But since that's what the man said, Gideon thought, well, you know, he's a stranger. So he took the broth, and he poured it over that. And with that, the minute he did that, suddenly fire sprang up, and it burned up the wet stuff. Now, we've seen fire before that has been able to burn wet stuff. And you know that fire came from heaven, because this is what the angel did. The angel touched it like that with his rod. And when he did, that's when it flared up and the fire came down from heaven. And what we know, or what Bible scholars, you know, men who really study the Bible, they think that this was the Lord Jesus in the Old Testament. You know, Jesus did not have his beginning as a baby in the manger. He did not have his beginning there. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit were with God in the very beginning when they created the world. And so this was what we called before a theophany. Remember, the theo means God, and theni means an appearance. So this is an appearance of God in the Old Testament. How could Jesus appear in the Old Testament? We know he wasn't born until later in Bethlehem. But you see, that's when he came to be a man. Remember, he was born as a baby, grew up so he could die on the cross for us. But the Lord Jesus, we've seen him in other times when he talked to Joshua, the Lord Jesus, because only the Son of God could come as a man. So when this fire went up like that and burned this up, the Bible calls him the angel of the Lord, and he disappeared. And of course the food was all burnt up. And so Gideon immediately said, "I'm going to die. I'm going to die because I have seen God." So he recognized that this was not just an angel. And since the angel was, able to do this miracle of burning up that food, and so Gideon then knew that he was to be the warrior that was going to save his people. Well, the angel, God told him from heaven. God spoke to him and told him, "I want you to go to that grove of trees where your father and where they have made this idol to Baal." And so that night Gideon went, and they had a grove of trees. Wait a minute, let me see if I could bring this so you can see it better. See the trees, and in that back in there see the idol of the Baal. And what Gideon and his men did is they tore it down. They broke it all to pieces. That idol no longer has a head. And they even cut down the trees to eliminate the grove so that they could no longer have an idol there to Baal. And so, wow. The next morning, what happened is the men in the town that worshiped Baal, they came out and they were after Gideon. They were going to, they were going to kill Gideon. They were going to kill Gideon for breaking down the altar to Baal and breaking the statue and everything. And so I have to really admire his father. Gideon's father's name was Joash. And this is what he did. He came and he saw what they were, that they were coming after his son. This is Joash, this is Gideon. And he went over here and he went to these men and he said to them, "Why are you after my son? Because he broke down the altar to Baal. How come Baal can't protect himself? If Baal is a god, why does he let people tear down his altars and his statues? Why would Baal do that?" And they finally, these men were convinced. You see, they have clubs in their hands. They were really going to kill Gideon for doing that. And Joash told them, he said, why do you have to protect a god? If he's God, why can't he protect himself?" And they agreed. They finally agreed and they left. And so now Gideon knows that he is going to be the one that's going to deliver his people. But he's just not so sure of himself. So what he did is he made an altar to the Lord in this area where he had seen the angel of the Lord, and he knew he had seen God. Well, really, what the one he saw was the Son of God. And so he made a sacrifice there to our one true God, okay? And so he was going to send out word to gather a big army. But instead, what he did is he went to the Lord in prayer, and he said, "Lord, I'm just not sure. I'm just not sure I can do this." So he said, "Please give me a sign. Will you please give me a sign that will show that you really are going to be with me?" And he says, "I'm going to put out this piece of fleece." Now, fleece is the wool off the back of a sheep, you know. The men had to always do what's called shear the sheep in the spring. See, in the wintertime, the animals grew lots of wool to protect them, to keep them warm. But in the spring, the men had to shear off that wool, and then the women could take that and make it into clothing. Wasn't that how God was providing for them? And so he said, "Lord, I'm going to put this fleece out here tonight, and when the dew comes down on it in the morning, I want the fleece to be wet. And I want the dew, all the ground around, not to have any dew on it. I want the ground around to be dry." Well, you know, if you ever go out, I used to go out to pick up my newspaper on my driveway. And if you picked up the newspaper and it was wet, trust me, the grass and the driveway and everything was wet. When dew comes down, it's like humidity and it's over everything. And so God said, Gideon said to God, "Make the fleece to be wet, but have the ground be dry." And when he went out in the morning, sure enough, the fleece was so wet, and he took and picked it up, and then he wrung it out over a bowl, and the bowl was full of water. And so Gideon knew that he had had an answer to his prayer. So there you go. Now he has an answer. God has showed him. Now the next thing is, he said, "Well, but Lord, I'm still not sure." I have to tell you, Gideon was not really a really, really super brave man, okay? But what he did is he said, "Lord, tonight, what the sign I want is I want the fleece to be dry and the ground around it to be wet." Now that's the opposite. So now he's asking for the opposite. And so when he went out the next morning, he put the fleece out for overnight, and the next morning when he went out, the fleece was dry. The fleece was dry as could be, but it was sitting in water. Look at that. See how it's in water? The fleece was dry and sitting in water from the dew, okay? This shows you what a wonderful answer he had to prayer. And so he made another sacrifice to the Lord to show God that he was willing then to do what God wanted him to do, okay? Now, you want to be sure and watch next week, because that's as far as I'm going to go with this story, because I don't want it to be too long, okay? But I love you all, and I hope you'll be back next Sunday and watch, because we're going to see how God really answered Gideon's prayers, and we're going to see a big battle. I know maybe you like to see battles, soldiers and that, okay? But we're going to see how God answered their prayer, and Gideon really was the hero of the whole thing, but actually it was God that was going to deliver them. But he was going to do it in a different way, a way that Gideon was not really anticipating. But God told him how to do it. Be sure to watch next week, okay? Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful lesson about Gideon. And help us, Lord, not that when we pray that we don't pray like that, being afraid that you won't answer. We know sometimes there are more than one answer to prayer. There's yes, no, and wait. So Heavenly Father, help us to understand that. Bless our pastor and Pastor Dan and the church service this morning. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.